so much. My name is Mariana Leach, and on behalf of the Culture Project, the thing always works. It's like really annoying, but it always works. Okay, so my name is Mariana, and on behalf of the Culture Project, I want to thank you so much for coming out tonight. We are absolutely ecstatic about how successful these events have been. Raise your hand if you have been to one of these already. Okay, awesome. That's a pretty great turnout. Okay, and now raise your hand if this is your first time ever at Love and Responsibility. Okay, you got like one or two. Perfect. Okay, so we're thrilled. This is our fourth week. Guys, this is week four, and it has been absolutely incredible. We could not do this without you, so thank you. I want to thank, we have so many people to thank for all of this. I want to, specifically, thank the Archdiocese for sponsoring us. We want to thank the seminary for hosting us here. Is this not the most beautiful place for us to host this event? It's fantastic, right? Okay. It's like, we are just living in love and responsibility. It's like Pride and Prejudice, right? Ladies, are you with me? Okay, thank you. Okay. Guys, we have a special treat tonight. Our speakers are some of the most incredible people I have ever met. We have, Megan and Jacob here from the Archdiocese. We're thrilled to have them. But before we introduce them, I just want to take a second to acknowledge why we're here. Okay, so who do we have here? Can you raise your hand for me if you're a single person in the audience? Single person. Perfect. Everyone always kind of like awkwardly laughs when we ask that question. We need to think about why, okay? So we have the single people. Can you raise your hand if we are seminarians? Okay, we're seminarians. Yes. Woo! And do we have any priests or religious with us tonight? Okay, no, yep. He's confused. He doesn't know who he is. We'll talk to him later. Okay, so, but thank God for our priests and for our religious and for everything that they do for us. Guys, we're asking that question because this event, Love and Responsibility, it's for everyone. The messages that we're talking about tonight are the universal messages of love and truth that answer the questions of every single human heart. So we're thrilled that you're here with us. And I just want to remind you that after this event tonight, all of these fantastic people, like take a second, look around, just make eye contact with somebody. Okay, those people, I want you to tell those people how they need to come to McShay's tonight, because after this event, we are all going out to McShay's. Well done. Wow, you really listened. Okay, now bring it back. So, we are going to McShay's tonight. It's in Narberth. It's like a 5-minute drive away from here. We're all going to be there after this event to discuss the things that we talk about. It's going to be fantastic. And you are invited. Okay, just a couple of announcements. Last week's talk, for those of you who may have missed it, or if you had people who were trying to watch it on our Facebook feed, it's up now, it's posted, and then we are live again tonight, so we're live on Facebook, so look your best, because people are going to see you. Probably not, but... speaking of our sponsors, not just the diocese has supported us, but Chick-fil-A. Yes. So I just want to point out that you did not clap for the diocese, but you did clap for the chicken. We have to work on that too. There's some things to work on. Practical points that everyone is probably interested in. If you are looking for the bathroom, it's going to be through those doors. You go down this hall, turn to the right. There are signs posted. You can't miss it. If you do, I'm sorry. As far as the drinks go tonight, can we just say a huge thank you for the free beverages that are being offered? I feel really okay. So, once everyone has had a chance to get their drinks, it feels like people probably have, but once everyone's had a chance, then you can go up for seconds, but not before that. Wait your turn. It's a nice thing to do. All of our food, like I said, it's donated, but we are still looking for those generous donations that will help us provide more events like this. So if you are looking for a generous donation to give, then there are places that you can do that on the bar. So please feel free. Consider a donation of $5 to $10 to help us cover costs, okay? All right. Final points. Books are for sale in the back. We are covering Men, Women, and the Mystery of Love by Dr. Edward Shree. It's an incredible text that has changed my life. It's the source of all of our information here, and we really recommend that you check it out. You can get those on the table that's in the back, just out there in the hallway. And finally, I would like to introduce our readers for the night. So I think almost everyone has been here before, but just in case you're not familiar, that our system is that we would like to start this event not just with our speakers, but by giving us all a chance to reflect on the content of the chapters that we're studying. So we're going to have some of the fantastic audience here read just little snippets, not the whole book, but a little glimpse into the material that we're going to cover tonight. So without further ado, can I call up our readers for the evening? Maybe? Good job, guys. Okay.
Chapter 7. Virtue is not simply something lacking in the modern world. It is something many in the modern world would actually resent. Living the virtuous life is not easy. It requires constant effort, practice, and self-denial as we battle against our fallen, selfish human nature. But not everyone wants to be reminded of this. For souls not wanting to give up certain pleasures or comforts, souls not wanting to do the work and make the sacrifices necessary to grow in virtue, any discussion of the virtues can be like a mirror reflecting back to them their own moral laziness. That's why some people resent the virtues. Instead of being inspired to live a better life, they tear down the moral standard of the virtues and drag it down to their own level. They minimize the significance of the virtues in order to spare themselves the effort and to excuse their own moral failures. Since they don't want to make the effort to change, they treat the virtues lightheartedly or even openly attack them in order to justify their own lack of moral character. He explains that resentment not only distorts the features of the good, but devalues that which rightly deserves respect, so that man need not struggle to raise himself to the level of the true good, but can lightheartedly recognize as good only what suits him, what is convenient and comfortable to him. The virtue that is probably resented most today is chastity. According to John Paul II, chastity is the virtue that frees love from utilitarian attitudes. The essence of chastity consists in quickness to affirm the value of the person in every situation, and in raising to the personal level all reactions to the value of the body and sex. Thus, chastity helps purify our hearts of selfish desires and make selfless, mature love between two persons possible. Today, however, chastity is no longer seen as something good, something noble, something we should all pursue. Just the opposite. Chastity is often portrayed as something evil or something harmful for human persons. When a Hollywood film or primetime comedy portrays romantic relationships, how often is chastity held up as a moral ideal? How often is chastity presented as something that makes us happy, as something the heroes intentionally make a priority in their lives? In the rare show that might actually have a character who is deliberately striving to live a chaste life, how is she portrayed? As beautiful, fun, and intelligent? In practically every case, the rare chaste character is portrayed as an awkward, judgmental, naive, or repressed woman who no one would ever want to imitate. Unless, of course, the director makes her in the end come of age and discover her true self precisely by shedding her traditional moral values and losing her virginity. The main reason modern man views chastity as an obstacle to love is that we associate love primarily with the emotions or the sexual pleasure we receive from a person. In other words, we tend to think of love only in its subjective aspect. However, a true, lasting love needs a stronger foundation. It must be based on virtue, a commitment to the other person's good, and the mutual self-giving, also known as the objective aspect of love. Therefore, the real question in love are not the subjective ones. Do I have strong feelings and desire for my beloved? Does he or she have strong feelings and sensual desire for me? Anyone can have feelings and desire for another person, but not everyone has the virtue and commitment to make self-giving love possible. Yet since the subjective aspect of love develops more rapidly and is felt more intensely than the objective aspect, many people confuse the feelings of love with love itself.
John Paul II says that when we encounter someone of the opposite sex, a stranger, a friend, a coworker, a boyfriend, a girlfriend, a spouse, or even another person's spouse, we should not expect a purely selfless attitude of Christian kindness to spontaneously spring from our hearts. Because we are fallen, our many complex attractions are often tainted by a selfish attitude of wanting to be with the other person, not for the sake of any commitment to his or her well-being, but for the rush of good feelings or sensual pleasure we may receive from being with that person. A special virtue is necessary to protect its true character and objective profile. This special virtue is chastity. Men and women without chastity are in a very sad situation. They are not free to love. They may have good intentions and a sincere desire to care for the beloved, but without chastity, love will never flourish, for it will not be pure. It will be mixed with the tendency to view the beloved primarily in terms of sexual values. But chastity protects love from falling into such utilitarianism. Free from utilitarian attitudes, the chaste are thus free to love. Thus also, the only chaste man and the chaste woman are capable. Only the chaste man and chaste woman are capable of true love. For chastity frees their association, including their marital intercourse, from that tendency to use a person which is objectively incompatible with loving kindness, and by so freeing it, introduces into their life together and their sexual relationship a special disposition to loving kindness. Chapter 8, The Battle for Purity. Chaste literally means clean. Christians have long used this word to describe the particular virtue that moderates our sexual desire. But this is not because the sexual desire itself is somehow unclean or dirty. In fact, John Paul II warned against a negative view of chastity that turns this virtue into a mere suppression of sensual desire. Don't have sex before you're married. In this negative light, chastity becomes merely the long no. This kind of suppression can have serious consequences for the human person. We must see chastity as a positive virtue that enables us to love and protects love from being tainted by the selfish tendency to use another person for our own pleasure. John Paul II said chastity is emphatically not one long no. Rather, it is first and foremost a yes in our hearts to the other person, not just to his or her sexual values. It is a yes that requires us to say no to other things in order to protect love from falling into utilitarianism. A sexual expression of complete self-giving love makes sense within marriage, where a husband and wife surrender themselves to each other completely in a lifelong commitment of love. Joe and his girlfriend, however, have not yet entered into such a relationship full of commitment and self-giving. A sexual relationship for them, therefore, would be a lie, devoid of the total lifelong commitment to each other as persons and the complete self-giving love that comes in marriage, sexual intercourse in the end would be about using each other for the pleasure associated with this profound act of love. Therefore, choosing chastity helps free them from such pleasure-seeking utilitarianism and enables their relationship to develop, possibly, into a deeper self-giving love. In short, chastity moderates our human desires for pleasure and allows us to experience a clear, pure love of the other person, a love that is truly centered on the other person's good, not just our own enjoyment.
One of the main fronts in the battle for purity is what John Paul II calls sensual egoism, which is the tendency to use another person for sensual pleasure. Certainly, various sinful sexual acts constitute this kind of egoism, but John Paul II stresses that one can fall into sensual egoism without making any bodily contact with another person. For example, as we saw earlier, a man can view a woman primarily in terms of the value of her body, and he can use her body as an object of enjoyment whenever he sees her, or even in his memory and imagination long after he has seen her. The Ten Commandments reflect this point. The Sixth Commandment, on one hand, addresses external physical actions in the realm of sex. You shall not commit adultery. The Ninth Commandment, on the other hand, addresses internal actions, commonly known as lustful thoughts. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife. But it's not always easy to discern the boundary between simply noticing someone's sexual values and being attracted to them in a sinful way. What is the difference between an innocent interest in another person's physical appearance and a lustful thought? One may experience a spontaneous sensual reaction. At this stage, one happens to notice the sexual values of another person's body and reacts to those values spontaneously. For example, a man walks into a cocktail party, catches the eye of a woman he has never met, notices the woman's attractive features, and finds himself drawn to her throughout the evening. The sexual values of the opposite sex often present themselves spontaneously like this. We notice the sexual values and find ourselves interested in them. This is not lust, nor is it sinful. It simply means we are human and have human sensual desire. Lustful thoughts. However, John Paul II warns us of how easy it is to move from the first stage of simple interest in the sexual values of another person to the second stage of hankering after them as a potential object of sensual pleasure. John Paul II calls this second stage sensual concupiscence. At this point, something within the person begins to stir, a desire for the sexual values of the other person's body as an object to enjoy. Now, the sexual values are not simply an object of interest, but an actual object of sensual desire in the heart. Something within us begins to strive towards, to hanker after that value. And this reaction can culminate in a desire to possess the value. Still, John Paul II says that even this second stage of sensual attraction is not necessarily sinful. It is the effect of concupiscence, our fallen inclination towards sin. Because of original sin, it is not easy for us to quickly direct that inner stirring of sensual desire to selfless love for the other person. Our desire for sensual pleasure is so powerful that we experience a desire to use the other person in order to gain that pleasure. But here is the key. Even this stirring of sensual desire is not in itself sinful, John Paul II says, as long as the will resists that desire to use the person, as long as the will does not consent to it. Indeed, we may experience sensual desire mounting intensely within us without our will actually consenting to it, and even with our will directly opposing it.
Don't expect immediate victory. That is why John Paul II wisely reminds us that we cannot expect to win the battle for purity in our hearts immediately, simply by saying no hardness. He says, an act of will directed against the sensual impulse does not generally produce any immediate result. In its own psychological sphere, a sensual reaction generally runs its full course, even if it means emphatic opposition in the sphere of the will. No, one can demand of himself either that he should experience no sensual reactions at all, or that they should immediately yield just because the will does not consent, or even because it declared itself definitely against. One must remember that as long as the will does not consent to those utilitarian desires, he or she has not fallen to sin. Sensual desire can be applied somewhat analogously to emotional attractions as well. A man may encounter a woman who has a warm personality and find himself instantly experiencing an emotional attraction to her. He didn't do anything to seek this out. It just happened. This is a spontaneous emotional reaction to the woman's femininity. However, just as we saw with sensual reactions, what one chooses to do with this initial sentimental attraction is crucial alone. It's just nice to have someone interested in me. Or, I didn't really want to date this guy. I felt good about myself knowing he was interested in me. I'm being pursued, I'm wanted, I'm interesting. But looking back, it was selfish. I was just using him to meet my emotional needs. This initial experience of various emotional attractions is in itself not sinful. If I am married to someone else, however, or if I am a priest or religious, these initial emotional attractions can become particularly dangerous if I'm not careful. In these cases, the vital question I must face is, what will I do with these sentiments? There are two options. I can choose to treat these feelings like impure thoughts and strive to prevent the emotional attraction from spinning out of control by turning away. I can curtail conversations with the person I'm attracted to, for example, or perhaps avoid spending time with the person. To be sure, some serious situations call for a complete break from any contact, since this may be the only way to free one's heart from the inappropriate emotional attachment. This initial experience of various emotional attractions is in itself not sinful. If I am married to someone else, however, or if I am a priest or religious, these initial emotional attractions can become particular. I think we read this. Okay. These initial emotional attractions can become particularly dangerous if I'm not careful. In these cases, the vital question I must face is, what will I do with these sentiments? There are two options. I can choose to treat these feelings like impure thoughts and strive to prevent the emotional attraction from spinning out of control by turning away. I could curtail conversations with the person I'm attracted to, for example, or perhaps avoid spending time with the person. To be sure, some serious situations call for a complete break from any contact, since this may be the only way to free one's heart from the inappropriate emotional attachment. Christ, however, wants us to live single-heartedly. He wants our hearts to be completely united to him and to our spouse. Only the person who is able to guard his heart, reserving it for his spouse, is able to live out his vocation faithfully and love his spouse with total self-giving love.
Catching on, we've decided that every week we're going to slip in just a slight mess up in the slides, and if you catch it, you win. So, good job. No, thank you so much to our readers and to Dr. Edward Shree for writing such fantastic content for us. It is now my profound honor to introduce Megan and Jacob. So they asked me to tell you just a little bit about them, and I don't have an official bio, but I do know some, just a couple of facts about them personally. So there are some things that very few people actually know about them. So when Jacob was in college, he spent some time in some of the Asian countries working on mission work over there. And very few people know that while he was over there, Jacob was actually part of a small group of people who they kind of rescued a small tiger, like a baby tiger. This is like a personal dream of mine, but Jacob was actually personally responsible for rescuing and raising this baby tiger into adulthood. So can we all just like thank Jacob for contribution? Very few people know that about him. Very few people know that. In fact, Jacob didn't know that about himself. And Megan. Megan, actually, that was not true, guys. And I'm really bad at delivering jokes on the spot, so I'm sorry. But hey, okay, be nice. So, I was kidding. sitting over there, I was like, what absurd thing could I say about them? Megan suggested that I tell you all that she was in Cirque du Soleil, so I don't know, I buy it, right? In all reality, I haven't had the privilege of getting to know Jacob that well, but I do know Megan, and I've gotten to encounter just her radical passion for the Lord, and I can personally vouch for what an impact she makes on every single person that she meets. The beauty of these two individuals is that they have given their entire lives over to ministry and to making a difference in our culture. We have the director and the assistant director of youth and young adult outreach for the Diocese of Philadelphia. So the Archdiocese of Philadphia, thank you, Mickey. So what that loosely translates to is that every young adult event that we go to, that we have the privilege of going to, has in some way been touched by these two people and by their countless hours of labor and of prayer for us. So that is more than enough of my rambling. I give you our speakers, Megan and Jacob.
Bucket is full. Thank you. Thanks, guys, for coming out. You obviously knew who your speakers were for tonight, and you decided to come anyway, so we feel really good about that. just to kind of set the stage, well, first of all, I chuckled when I read the chapters for this week and knew that we were presenting on them, because a few weeks ago, in my small group, I was sharing with the people in my small group that, like, some of the teaching I kind of resented. I don't know if I used those words, but I was like, this is really difficult sometimes, and like, I don't know how to do this, you know? And I even shared with them a story of me babysitting my niece, who's 6 years old and obsessed with Disney and love and fairy tales, and we were watching some Disney movie, and at the end, the prince and the princess, they get married, true love's first kiss, or whatever, and she wants to enter into this scene, and, you know, she wants to be at the ball and dance, you know, and make her living room part of this movie, which is, you know, excellent for a little child and her imagination, and I'm, like, in the corner smoking a cigarette, like, yeah, kid, get over it, ain't real. The cigarette part wasn't true, but I did tell her. I had a kind of sit-down conversation with her. I was like, we need to talk about your expectations and wishful thinking and God's desire for you, because you're probably going to be enough. But she was very upset with me. This is legit. She actually was very upset with me. She didn't want to talk to me for the rest of the night. We're good now. But I understand, you know, this resentment, and even in virtue, when I first moved back to Philly, so Jacob and I actually just essentially started in the office, and so it was in the fall when I moved back to Philadelphia, and I was talking to one of my friends, and she was talking about prayer life and all this, and I was not in a good place coming from Baltimore. I won't go there, but I felt that, you know, that resentment, like, this is just too good. This morning, I resented patience as I was driving into work and had choice words for everyone, you know, in the cars next to me. I wasn't thinking of them as a brother or sister in Christ. So Jacob and I, we have a story, and we're just pilgrims on the journey with you guys. So let tonight just be us kind of sharing what we've learned along the way and what has helped us to overcome that resentment, or to overcome the battle that we're all in for virtue and for life with Christ. So Jacob's actually going to kick it off, and we thought it would be a good idea to show a video from his high school. So you might even see him in the stands. But it's very accurate, okay, and it really does actually paint a picture of why we might resent chastity and why people repel it, or why people think it's just a bunch of rules.
My name is Brother Timothy, and I have been sent to preside over this series of dances. First of all, I'd like to welcome the Virgin Martyr girls and thank them for coming. Friday Novena this coming Friday. Now, let me introduce to you Father Abruzzi, who will be giving the first talk. Thanks. Father? These dances are designed to help you learn to interact with one another in a way befitting young men and women of a strong moral fiber. You're all at an age now when you're perhaps beginning to notice the difference between the boys and the girls. This is every other important moment of your life. The church is here to guide you. Many of you will be experiencing certain feelings. Feelings which you might be inclined to confuse with love. But ladies and gentlemen, never confuse love with the deadliest of the seven deadly sins.
Things that have held us back, or at least myself, from wanting to live chastity, is just my thought of chastity. I didn't even want to start. I think a lot of times you go into CCD, or I think CRE, call it Catholic Church Dungeon. We literally push a kid down the stairs. That's what I remember from CCD. But God kind of seemed like the church lady. Or sort of like that priest where sex seemed like something dirty. And if you're giving a chastity talk, it's just keep it in your pants. All right, you guys got it? That's it. So it didn't even seem desirable. And so after my conversion, I had a conversion. I didn't go to Asia. I did drop out of high school, and I was evangelized later. But after my conversion, I had a great scripture professor, who phenomenal, Dr. Bergsma, Franciscan. And so when I would read the Bible, there was a ton of laws in it. And God, and the famous ones were the Ten Commandments, but he almost seemed like sort of a, I don't know if I can say this, a hard ass? Or some crude with a ton of laws who would zap you if you disobeyed. Our priest at Franciscan would say it's the divine guillotine. He's like, he's a high school dropout. But then my professor said, all those laws were given because man's heart had become cold. In the beginning, the law of God was written upon the human heart, upon Adam and Eve's heart. He said, until sin, God only gave two commands. And the first one was found in Genesis 1:28. And the command was, be fruitful and multiply. That means the first of the two commands that God gave, that all he needed to give, was that thou shalt make love in paradise. That was half of the command. I was like, all right, that makes sense. That's sweet. So that sort of started getting me interested. Then I got interested in C.S. Lewis. And he said this in Mere Christianity. I know some muddle-headed Christians have talked as if Christianity thought that sex or the body or pleasure were bad in themselves. But they were wrong. Christianity is the only one of the great religions which thoroughly approves of the body, which believes matter is good, that God himself once took on a human body, and that some kind of body is going to be given to us in heaven and is going to be an essential part of our happiness, our beauty, and our energy. Christianity has glorified marriage more than any other religion, and nearly all the greatest love poetry in the world has been produced by Christians. If anyone says that sex in itself is bad, Christianity contradicts him at once. One more teaching, so I was trying to pick a few. The next teaching was from Love and Responsibility itself. And it was from John Paul II. When I read this, my mind was blown. I was like, did someone forget to give Grandpa his medicine? I can't believe he said that. From an altruistic standpoint, it is necessary to insist that intercourse must not serve merely as a means of allowing sexual excitement to reach its climax in one of its partners, i.e. the man alone, but that climax must be reached in harmony, not at the expense of one partner, but with both partners fully involved. I had to think, like, what did he just say? He said it's your moral obligation to make sure that your wife enjoys everything. Enjoy sex. And this is a celibate man in Rome that they made Pope. Right? So the confessional line, like the priest asked, like, are you? No, sorry. Okay, so those were a few things that helped me get over, okay, God isn't the church lady. He's not some prude up in heaven. And Becky and I were talking about, we're trademarking our office, so we're going to rename our office, TBD. But we're like, sex? God, we have to go through this trademarking process. But God has a trademark on sex. He created it. He masterminded it. We can't even visualize the conversations that must have led to that. Okay, another thing that made me like not want to do the chastity thing is you're like, all right, God might have a trademark on sex, but one thing that said, he might have the trademark, but Playboy takes sex from good to great. All right. It's almost like, oh, that's wonderful. But then we're presented with Playboy, Maxwell, all these different things, pornography that says, This is how you really enjoy sex. But leave it to St. Thomas Aquinas. The dude wrote so much, I'm not surprised that he wrote on this. St. Thomas Aquinas said that sexual pleasure was even greater before the fall, because the fallen can never give as much pleasure as the unfallen. Said sin did not increase pleasure, but greatly diminished it. And then I just took a course on love. Have you guys heard about a philosopher named Joseph Pieper? Yeah, I think I said his name right. All right. Is it Piper or Pieper?
Piper.
Okay.
You say Pieper, I say Piper.
Great. So he says this. And so he says, sin continues not only to separate us from God, but it even diminishes us farther in the actual sexual experience. And he says this in his book about love. He says, sex paradoxically rather separates than unites man and woman, leaving them alone and lonely precisely where they thought they would surely find each other. Such sex consumption increases, this effect is intensified, and the sexual encounter becomes increasingly disappointed. Said the result is not what Sigmund Freud's generation expected from the abolition of sexual taboos, but rather the forfeit of value by making intercourse free. Says, what can be had on demand and almost at once as well, necessary loses both its value and its attractiveness. The head of the health center at American State University, a psychiatrist by profession, reported that some of the more promiscuous girl students replied in answer to inquiry that it's just too much trouble to say no. At first hearing that may sound like the sheerest freedom, but clearly it also means, I don't really care. It doesn't matter. The inevitable result is already implicit. Sexuality not only without joy, but without pleasure. So much sex and so little meaning even takes the fun out of it. And he also quotes a philosopher that says, where Playboy is concerned, the fig leaf has merely been moved to another place. It now covers the human face. And he says, they don't want a woman or man, but a neuter. And they want sex totally separated from love. And that's what John Paul II is talking about. And that's why the Playboy mindset is so dangerous and that lie is so dangerous. Because it causes egoism. It's a me versus we. It doesn't unite lovers, but divides. And there's a great book called Severe Mercy by Sheldon Van Auken. And he said the most dangerous thing to a relationship is creeping separateness. It's when lovers start to drift apart. And he says that's the failure behind the failure. Either love must grow or it will die. And this lie that says, from Playboy, from pornography, says, hey, we do it even better. He says that's the fastest way to kill love. And now, it's not just us church prudes up here who work at the Archdiocese. Who are preaching this. So there was an article in GQ, and I read it, I was like, what? 10 reasons why you should quit watching porn. And so in GQ they said, according to a website called ProjectNo.com, 420 million web pages are dedicated to porn, meaning the non-porn internet roughly consists of, well, Wikipedia. Scientists at Cambridge University recently studied the brain scans of porn addicts and found that they looked exactly like those of drug addicts. With such an inexhaustible supply of porn at our disposal, there is a growing concern that is beginning to affect our brains, our relationships, and even our bodies. You say, here are some of the reasons why it might be a good idea to stick to Netflix next time you open up your laptop. And I highlighted a few. For those addicted to porn, arousal actually declined with the same mate. Those who found different mates were able to continue their arousal. It's known as the Coolidge effect, or a tendency toward novelty-seeking behavior. Porn, after all, trains the viewer to expect constant newness. They say 64% report that their tastes in porn have become more extreme or deviant, and 25% are disinterested in sex with their partner. That does not sound like a recipe for a happy marriage, for a happy relationship. And we also have this really good Catholic speaker that speaks on porn. Just kidding. Russell Brand did a video, a famous actor, and he's shirtless, and he has like the sheet over. But we're going to show you this real quick on Russell Brand's thoughts on pornography.
A quote from a priest who said, pornography is not a problem because it shows us too much, it's a problem because it shows us too little. I don't think when that priest means you would like to see more gynecological and more sort of filthy shots of things. I think what you're saying is that pornography reduces the spectacle of sex to a kind of extracted physical act. There's a lot of statistics here that we've got about pornography. The Journal of Adolescent Health talk about the effects of prolonged exposure to porn, including an exaggerated perception of sexual activity in society. Yeah, I think that'd be diminished trust between intimate couples. I get that sometimes. The abandonment of hope of sexual monogamy. Sometimes I wonder if it's possible. The belief that promiscuity is the natural state. I don't want to have that belief because I was obsessed with porn when I was a teenager, and it was nostalgic mad stuff that makes me sound old. We had to find magazines places and steal things from under beds. So living in this culture now where there's just icebergs of filth floating through every house on Wi-Fi, it's inconceivable what it must be like to be a young adolescent boy now with this kind of access to porn. It must be dizzying and exciting, but corrupting in a way that we can't even think about. In fact, Jill Manning, the sociologist, says the upper limits of the impact of this amount of porn have yet to be fully realised because these people haven't reached sexual maturity. But I think my own relationship with pornography is kind of the hub of my feelings of inner conflict and doubt. I know that pornography is wrong, I shouldn't be looking at it, but lots of people that are working in it are doing so because of the wrong reasons, desperation, self-doubt. I'm sure there's loads of people that work in porn and go, hey, I love it, but there's a general feeling in the core, if you look at pornography, that this isn't what's the best thing for me to do, this isn't the best use of my time now. I don't put that laptop lid down and think, there! What a productive piece of time spent in the world.
Storyline may be on something. In fact, a new study says the more dominant one partner is, the happier the couple.
I feel like if I had total dominion over myself, I would never look at pornography again. One day at a time, I'd kick it out of my life. And one of the reasons that I've sensed that pornography isn't good for me as an individual is because of this. The kind of conclusions reached by Gary R. Brooks, who's observed the consumption of softcore pornography, like Playboy. He's talking about the five main symptoms of looking at softcore porn. But softcore porn really is everywhere. 50 Shades of Grey is softcore porn. TV adverts, billboards are full of softcore porn. And here are some of the effects of this, the symbolism of this culture. Voyeurism, an obsession with looking at women rather than interacting with them. I do that sometimes, I think that woman looks beautiful, I don't think, oh, I hope she gets on well with her dad, I hope she doesn't have diabetes, what's she like, soul as another person here in the space, I just think, oh, she looks nice. Objectification, an attitude in which women are objects, rated by size, shape, harmony, and body parts. Guilty of that all of the time. Because, you know, I've been acculturated and trained to. This is something that I work on. Like, no, come on, see everybody as equal human beings. But once that biological drive to procreate is connected with a culture of objectification, that's a very hard equation to break. Validation, the need to validate masculinity through beautiful women. This is something that I've suffered from terribly. Trophyism, the idea that beautiful women are collectibles who show the world what a man is. Oh no, I've done that before. Fear of true intimacy, inability to relate to women in an honest and intimate way despite deep loneliness. Oh God! Pornography results man's sexual need over his need for sensuality and intimacy. I think because I've been exposed to such a lot of pornography from such a young age, it's clear that those phenomena I personally relate to. You know, sometimes you read in Facebook ads a lot, Coswallop. Me, pornography is not something I like, it's something that I haven't been able to make a long-term commitment to not looking at, and it's affected my ability to relate to women, to relate to myself, my own sexuality, my own spirituality. So a film.
I do find it funny that he decided to go for the toga look for talking about pornography. He's like a bunch of other videos and he's fully clothed. But I guess it's kind of appropriate. But I admire this complete honesty that he has in this little video. I mean, in the introspection that he has. Assuming, and I don't know his heart, I don't know his journey, but assuming that he has not been, like he doesn't have an openness to grace, maybe. I mean, he did talk about the priest, I don't know if you guys caught that in the beginning, the priest. That's Pope John Paul II, that quote. Pornography is not showing too much, it's showing too little. So I think we all should pray for him tonight. I mean, really, he's obviously open, and he's obviously looking for something more. And what I think is so heroic of him is that he calls out the dissatisfaction of the counterfeit. He calls out his desire, he calls out his biological reaction, but he calls out that it's just not satisfying, that it's not lasting, it's not working. So Jacob talks about God, the ultimate romantic, who trademarked sex, who's not ashamed of it. And this world, I mean, we have so many misconceptions, right? We've got, father of Jacob's high school. Hugh Hefner, which is a very, dramatic example. But it's very subtle, too, and we all know this. I don't feel like I have to debunk any of this for you. Like, we are in a very over-sexualized culture, mis-sexualized misconception of our sexuality culture. And now, more so than ever. And what he says, about the influx of images that are just pouring through like icebergs, he says, which I don't know why I use that example, but it worked. Flooding through the channels of people's homes at as young as 6-7 years old. I mean, there's going to be confusion, and there's going to be a battle that we're in. And he says that, he talks about his inner conflict, and that if he could, he would never look at porn again. If he had full dominion over himself, he would never look at porn again. And he talks about what JP2 coined as sensual concupiscence, which I think was probably what he was trying to say, but he put it in his own terms. And we read this in the beginning, but I just want to read a little section of it again. So sensual concupiscence is the second stage. And at this point, something within the person begins to stir, a desire for the sexual values of the other person's body as an object to enjoy. Now, the sexual values are not simply an object of interest, but an actual object of sensual desire in the heart. Something within us begins to strive towards, to hanker after that value. And this reaction can culminate in a desire to possess the value. Still, John Paul II says that even this second stage of sensual attraction is not necessarily sinful. And I think what Sri is trying to get at in his second, in the eighth chapter here, Battle for Purity, is that very moment. It's that moment of temptation that is important. I mean, if we don't recognize that we're in a battle, we're losing. Really, we're losing because we're just going with the culture. And like he said, this is how I've been programmed. I've been acculturated this way. So he wasn't necessarily aware of this battle. And even us, I know for me, I can often forget that I am in a battle. And not to overemphasize it, you know, you become kind of weird. But if you don't recognize, then you're already losing. And it's going to look different for men and women. And as I was thinking about, you know, my own personal battles and the resentments that I've had and the letdowns that I've had and the impure relationships that I've had and my desire to be holy and my desire to be pure, I was reflecting on, like, what I think works for me and what I think the root is. And the root is really when we forget who God is. And that's essentially what happened in the garden. When we forget who God is, we forget who we are. You forget who you are as male or female. And that's essential to who we are. People are trying to divorce that from themselves, and it's causing mass chaos and confusion. And we've forgotten, and we can forget every day. I forget every day, all the time, who I am. The Hebrew meaning for woman is pronounced nekeva. It's to be open and to be pierced. And this is written in our bodies. And the lie that was whispered to woman was that God is a liar. That was the first lie. God is a liar. And he doesn't have your best interest in mind. He lied to you. So you take matters into your own hands. You take control. And it's the same damn lie. I hear it every day. It's the same damn lie. He's a liar. He doesn't want to protect you. He doesn't have your best interest in mind. And what this looks like for females, it can look like, well, first of all, when we're not open, we're closed. So we're closed off to God, which can build these real negative fruits in our lives of resentment, of jealousy, of comparison, of putting other people down, of incredible body insecurity. And especially, like, it doesn't matter if you have known about theology body for 10 minutes or 10 years, this lie and this temptation will forever be whispered in our ear. And we have to recognize that. That the lie that one of my deepest desires is to be beautiful. That's written in my very being. And so when I close off to God, when I'm not open to his will as Our Lady, I'm becoming less of who I am, becoming less beautiful. Femininity is not a look, you know? It's not like, it doesn't matter if you play female rugby or if you knit sweaters, you know? It's being open to God. That's the heart of it. And that's what Satan's going to attack. And we see it rampantly. It's so obvious. So as people who are trying to learn more about the Lord, trying to learn more about ourselves and our sexuality and what we're made for, we have to be very aware that this will come like that. And we can entertain it, and we can dance with it, and we can play that negative soundtrack. Some of us, like, we know every single lyric to it of how we are not good. And this is similar to men. I mean, a lot of these truths are the same for men. The Hebrew word for a man is zikar, which means to remember. So in the garden, at the very beginning, it was in man's written, stamped into his body to remember the covenant of God, to remember God's faithfulness. And in that, the willingness to protect the covenant and to protect the woman. And the innate desire to, like, sacrifice for that, to lay down his life for that. And it is so written into man's being that the spiritual core is hungry. So And Satan is not creative. It's the same lies. So like Russell Brand was saying, there's this temptation to conquer. There's this temptation not to conquer oneself, to conquer one's sin, to die to self, to die to this, the you know, temptations, but to conquer woman. And he said it really well. The male validation of masculinity is to objectify the woman. And that's what he's been fed. And he recognizes, like, there's something wrong with that. But we're all, us, Russell Brand, we're all in this battle. And so what do we do with that? How do we conquer these things? I have four practical things. And this was actually made kind of aware to me when I was a campus minister at an all-girls high school in Baltimore. So that's where I was before I came to, I was in Philly, then I went to Baltimore, and then I moved back to Philly. In my time during Baltimore, I thought, like, I'm going to just show these girls their worth, and I'm going to just show them how loved they are. And God, he was like, oh, really? Well, let's talk about you for a second, because you don't even know. Like, you have been feeding these lies and these insecurities in yourself. And I think this applies both to men and women. And how to fight this is, first of all, we have to know the temptation. We have to know when that temptation sets in. And it's in that moment that our power lies. It's in that moment that we pick up the cross and that we kiss it. And it doesn't feel good, but that's the moment that makes us overcome this resistance that we have to virtue, this resistance that we have to chastity, or, you know, other virtues as well. So casting out lies. We are baptized, we have power, and we need to utilize that power. I want some of that. Like, I want to be able to cast out in the name of God because I can, because it's written and it's promised by God that we have that power. We are priests, prophets, and kings, and we can do that. So to cast out the temptation, cast out the thoughts, and be specific. In that moment, I cast out, in the name of Jesus, the lie that I am not good enough. Because that lie is a root. If you don't know who you are, chastity doesn't make sense. Chastity will be a bunch of rules. If you don't know that you are good and that you are worthy and that you are loved, it will seem oppressive. So casting that out, whatever temptations or lies that you might be faced with, claiming the truth, this is just modeling after what the Lord himself did in the desert. He was tempted, and what did he do? He, in that moment, he claimed the truth of who his father was, who his father is, who he is. And that truth has power. So to claim, I have, by the power of God, I have the power to overcome this lustful desire. And in that moment, then to turn to the Holy Spirit, that's the next thing. The Holy Spirit is like waiting to help us. I mean, we can't do this without the Holy Spirit. We can't. The Spirit of God himself. I mean, if I had like the spirit of Mozart, I'd be able to compose beautiful music that makes people cry, or makes me cry at least. Side note, total side note, when I was listening to classical music on my headphones today, why am I singing this in front of everyone? It was so beautiful, I would start to cry, so I was like, anyway, okay. Erase that from your memory and from Facebook Live, if you can do that. But the Spirit of God, you, of course, through Christ we can do all things. So these things, even when I was in that small group, like I said a few weeks ago, like, wow, this is difficult, or I don't believe. I'm struggling with unbelief right now, that this is meant for me. It is that moment that, you know, we're called to invite the Holy Spirit in to tell us the truth and to enlighten us. It works every time. And lastly, fast. This is coming from someone who's really bad at fasting. I've had to remind myself it's Lent, like, every day. This is also coming from a girl who grew up in a very Italian household and probably has an entire loaf of bread undigested in my intestines somewhere. This is a life of manja after I ate my second plate of pasta and block of Parmigiano Reggiano at 11 a.m. So fasting wasn't part of my childhood or my life and portion control. Anyway, but fasting, our body, you can't have body without a soul. You can't, like, we're body and soul. So when you're fasting with your body, you're training your soul. It's a great way to grow in that virtue. My last, just how to tie this up. Well, then you might be asking, wondering, at least me, and when I was writing out this outline, I was like, well, what about my desires? Like, I have desires that I, what do I do? There's three things that I could think of, there might be more, but three things that came to my mind. You either lock them up and repress them and live by the letter of the law and therefore become the church lady, example A.
Jokes about Anthony's wiener. Yeah, not quite the back of Jesus, is it?
Well, I think that Jesus appreciates a good joke, doesn't he?
Jesus loves a good joke. So that would leave you out of the equation, wouldn't it?
Too much. So you can become the puritanical church lady who thinks rap music is from the devil. Or, you can let your desires loose. You can let them go without any direction, without any goal, without any structure or sacrifice, and maybe become a little bit more like my good friend. There
Jan you. Told me to play it cool, and not tell anybody because it gets both in trouble. So, officially, I did not see her. But I did see Jan in our room. At night and in the morning. That's all I'm gonna say. Sorry. Sex. We had sex.
Okay.
I had sex with her.
Okay.
I had sex with you.
Is this too much? Sorry, not sorry. Gosh, it's too good. So without, when your desires are not directed, when they're not placed at the feet of something greater, you might find yourself in the position of Michael Scott. Or, I don't know, someone more dramatic, Nicki Minaj or something. And maybe, okay, not even so dramatic, and this is something I think that should be talked about, just very briefly, in what he talks about here, very briefly, is when it's unchecked, it's the little thing, like emotional virtue, emotional lust is a thing. It's a real thing. I mean, I was just talking to a girl, and the conversation went something sort of like this. I mean, I might be dramatizing it a little bit, but... you know, she was saying how this guy, this really cute guy that she had a crush on, was like, hey, you know, maybe, do you want to, like, grab a glass of water or something sometime? That's what he said, and what she heard was, hey, do you want to name our first three kids Peter, James, and John? Like, she really ran with this invitation to grab a drink. It wasn't water, it was out, right, at a bar. I don't think I have to explain that, but the emotional, like, she wasn't checking it, and it's room for disappointment and misplaced wishful thinking, misplaced hope. very dangerous, and you have these, and then that resentment can build within that person. And I've been there plenty of times. But ultimately, I think what John Paul II, the whole point of his teaching, that's really bold for me to say. talking like I know. I do believe one of the main points is that we go before the one who will satisfy all of our desires, whether you are single or married or dating or religious, and we let our desires bleed before him. The saints lived in this very, like, beautiful balance of feeling, of desiring, and not entertaining it, but not letting it go wild. That's virtue, right? The mean between two extremes. Chastity makes sense when we let God love us, really, I think at the end of the day. When we know that we are loved by God, we won't resent it. You know, chastity will not be just a bunch of no's, but a greater yes to the one who wants to satisfy the desires of our heart. Chastity means clean, as he said. And this is something I think that we need to really think about. I mean, if we try to clean ourselves, we're going to become very discouraged. It's not us trying to perfect ourselves or trying to do the right thing. It's literally going to the cleaner, as corny as that was, and I just said that. But he's the one that cleans. He's the one that orders. St. Teresa of Avila said something. If you persevere with courage, God will change you. God will ultimately order us and change our hearts and put us on the right path very gently. My neighbor, I'll end with this, I promise. Keep going. My neighbor, I've known her my entire life, since my earliest memories. And I remember when she was married to Richard. And I remember when she left Richard and started to live a homosexual lifestyle. And we lived in a cul-de-sac, and my family is open door all the time. Come everyone, you know, just very welcoming. So this person has been a part of my life. My family has never shunned her. They have never judged her. She, up until this day, I mean, she is very close with our family. She's kind of alone at this point. So we've really welcomed her in. She was at my grandma's deathbed, you know, like very close with our family. So she trusts us. And she's just recently started to open up to me about her lack of satisfaction and her loneliness and ache in this life. And she travels all over the world, and she always has these different girlfriends, and she's experiencing conversion. I mean, we've prayed together, we've shared music together, Bible verses, and this has taken a long time. But what she said that stuck out to me, she said, It is more difficult, actually, at this point in my life, to fall back into that lifestyle than it is to follow Jesus. Because she's been so exhausted by the sin. She's exhausted. She's empty. She has nothing, you know? And, like, it's just easier to fall at his feet. And that's literally all we have to do. And so, in this, like, Edward Treece said, you know, don't expect victory overnight. It takes time, and it takes us just saying yes and going before him and asking for grace. We cannot do this without grace. Russell Brand, you want it? You're missing grace. You're missing the one that will actually help you do it, because good luck trying to live chastity without it and without the sacraments, without the grace of confession. So with that, I guess we'll just close with a really quick prayer, and then let you guys get to small group. In the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. God, you are our Father, and you are good.
And we thank you for bringing us here. We thank you for your faithfulness, even when we are unfaithful. We thank you for your patience with us. We thank you for your generosity. We ask that you please satisfy the desires of our heart. We ask that you, you be the object of our life, that we seek you with our whole heart, soul, mind, and strength. We love you. Amen. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks, guys. Just one more quick round of applause. Thank you to Megan and Jason. Absolutely incredible. Before we got started today, I was speaking with someone and we were talking about how refreshing it is to come to an event, like this with young adults, people our age who understand exactly where we are in this state of life, and to be hearing authentic truth. So thank you so much, and thank you for those fantastic videos as well. Very quickly, we are going to break off into small groups. So this doesn't have to be like a huge logistical, chaotic thing. All we're gonna do, just look around and make eye contact with the people that are in your near vicinity, form a group of 8 to 10 people, and our small group leaders are gonna come to you. Small group leaders, can you raise your hands, please, just so people know where you are, what you look like. Okay, they are coming for you. So form your little group of people, and we'll just have an opportunity to discuss the things that we've heard about.
Thank you. not a like some like type of like religious truth. It's just like a human truth, even then. Yeah, he obviously, he's not a Christian like at all. He's actually raised his child as a gender. But like, I think it's like obvious that just in like human experience of relationships, I think like understand it. And like the like a feeling of the truth. And he would have assumed that he would know how to
thank you. Okay, now I've been a date, and be attracted to people like only, like,
checklist. This person is this, this, this. So I guess it makes sense. So I guess I'm gonna do that. And then it's just like not like human.
Yeah. Also, and this is like from a left.
I don't have to do anything. Just,
all right.
No responsibility. No.
Excuse me, friends, my dear friends. So we are, if you could just kind of take a minute to wrap up the discussions that you're having. Megan and Jacob have bravely come back up to the front of the room to answer questions for just a brief Q&A session. So you could just take about 60 seconds to wrap up whatever point you're on, and we will get started. All right, everybody. Okay, so we are officially going to close the small groups and open it up for large group Q&A. So this is an opportunity for everyone, if you have a question specifically for Megan and Jacob that you would love them to pour their wisdom out on, then this is an opportunity to ask that question. Or if you have a specific point of feedback that you think would be valuable, then this is an opportunity for that as well. So. Who's going first? Yes. Oh, not you. Not you, Will. Chris. Megan and Jacob would respond to question four. So guys, how do you think that a positive, integrated vision of sexuality could be more effectively promoted in the midst of our culture? What can be done within your own life, family life, the church, schools, and work environments? I'm going to give this to them.
Walk over there. Got anything?
Solve the world's problems with one answer right here. Go. Something that comes to my mind is trying to fight the stereotypes like we were talking about earlier, is having a positive spin. I think a lot of times we go to the defensive, which is good. We need to defend the teachings of the church. We need to defend chastity. We need to defend marriage. But we got to figure out ways to play offense. We got to figure out ways to get out there and sort of take the lead in the culture. So that's what Megan and I, we just spent a week in Canada. Vancouver with a sweet media marketing company, Glass Canvas, and we were coming up with ways that we're going to be launching here pretty soon that we can take the offensive. And somebody who's done this, done a phenomenal job, is Pope Francis. He's somebody who just come out in the culture and just won so many hearts. And so what he's done is he's barely talked about chastity. He's won people over by his love, by his authenticity, and his faith and his joy is contagious. I remember seeing him in D.C. and we waited. We got there at like 4 in the morning. And I thought we had tickets to go in Congress, so I was like, like dressed up, and we were just on the lawn, and we had to get there at 4 a.m., and he didn't speak until 11 a.m., and you couldn't move, so you were just, like, stuck there. I'm like, I'm going to go to the bathroom, and the guy looked at him like this, blows, but he came out at 11 a.m. like this, better be good, and it was, I don't know if it was that worth it, but it was awesome, and something he just... Just the way he spoke, and he's like, if you pray, please pray for me. If you don't pray, wish me well. And the way he spoke, John Boehner, who was like that big shot at the time, was bawling like a baby. And he barely got to say anything, because when you encountered him, he was so authentic. And I think what we have to do is we just have to, Thomas Merton says, don't hate the hatred out there. Don't hate the unchaste out there. Hate it in yourself and reform yourself. One of our patron saints is St. Francis. How did he, his mission was to rebuild the church, but that's not how he started. His mission first was to rebuild himself. And God saw that and he was ready then to build the church. So I think it starts with us. Just in the family, so I have 3 kids, troublemakers at home. My wife's probably watching, probably not. She's like, you're boring. I would say one thing I want to encourage is my kids to be always open with me. To not be scared. To share things that happen. Look, I'm a sinner. I was a big sinner, and I still sin. I want them to know if they make a mistake, they can come to me. And I'm going to help them through it. Like, we have to almost renew our minds on God constantly. And one of the things is thinking that God is this divine judge, this old man who wants to zap us, like we're talking about. He wants us to come just to be with him and to spend time. And he wants us to encourage and be open. So that's one thing that I would encourage, like, as you move forward with families, as you, with your friends. Not judgmental, I'm just here to help. What can I do?
Yeah, and just, like, really quick, the woman I was talking about, my neighbor, she reached out to me, and she knew what I was about, and she's just a friend of mine. So I think she just saw something in me that attracted her. So I would just say, I mean, it's going to sound a little, like, cliche, maybe a little bit of a cop-out, but just to, like, be authentic and be yourself and... that's attractive, and I think that's going to promote inspiration among people and what they truly desire. Good question.
Chris, so how do we take that boldness of authentic and the desire to be authentic and translate that into saying yes to exploring vocation, both religious as well as saying yes to a date or asking somebody out, and how do we be bold in those vocational choices to actually get the gumption to do it?
Do a shot. It's a good question, and I mean, I am right there with you, you know. I think, kind of going off of what I just said, like, in authenticity, when you are just yourself, which is not always easy. Like, it's really not. I noticed that among myself, too. Like, the, you know, family mask, the work mask. I don't have a mask, actually, at work. I think the boldness, like, there's certain personality types, right? But, girl, if you want to ask someone out, you should pray for the courage, do it. And take a shot. I don't know.
So the question was on discerning too, like how to choose your vocation.
I missed the essence.
She isn't drinking, probably. I would say the first thing that you have to focus on is my favorite quote from G.K. Chesterton is let your religion be less of a theory and more of a love affair. Why I converted, I was a high school dropout. And these two Christians at work, one was a missionary, took me to see the Passion of Christ. And I went, and I was raised Catholic, I like movies, I like popcorn. So I went with them, and I was, so we got into the movie, and I did not expect that. And towards the end, my heart just exploded. And it changed my life. And at that moment, my religious vocabulary was terrible. My regular vocabulary was terrible. But I just said, and it was the most honest prayer I've ever prayed in my life. I was like, I want to do something for Jesus. Like, I want to do something for Him. And it just sort of like stole my heart in a weird way. I know that sounds weird. But I just wanted to give my life over to Him. And just being totally detached. Like, Lord, this life is short. I know somebody else can bring me happiness, but my ultimate happiness is in You. And I'll do whatever You want. If You laid Your life down for me, You gave me everything, I give You everything. And I know it's difficult sometimes, but every day I want to wake up and give You my life like You gave me Yours. And so I think it starts there. And it just starts with peace. And God starts opening the doors. I mean, I was a high school dropout. I didn't, like, I stopped going to classes my freshman year of high school. Never read a book until I was 19. And then He opened doors in my life, and now I'm a director of youth and young adult ministry. And we're working with Archbishop Jack Pugh to help for the synod in Rome. And he's the head of youth and young adult ministry for the USCCB, and he's looking to us to help him. So the Lord will do things in your life if you're in love with Him. And all you just have to worry about is just being in love with Him.
And I got tripped up on the bold part, but I think my temptation is to almost like idolize vocation, and vocation is a gift. It's a pure gift. And it's not the end, you know, it's a means to the end, in a way. It points to the giver. And I think I've made promises with God that He hasn't made. I've put words into His mouth. I have confused hope with entitlement and thinking, like, I'm entitled to this. But really, it's very narrow-minded of me to think that, like, someone in a vocation as opposed to someone not is missing out on the goodness of God, you know? And it's not easy, but, I think it's just realigning that hope. The hope it comes from a profound relationship with God, and hoping in eternity, keeping our eyes on eternity and knowing that we are like dust. And to dust we shall return. Amen.
Mouth of Nicky's.
Any other questions? Will?
So our group was talking, and we finished on a kind of unanswered question. And all together, we were talking about, we were talking about how there's a lot of striving for virtue where, for instance, courage, you can say, I need to grow in courage, you know, like, it's hard for me, so I'm going to put myself in a situation where my, courage is tested. difficult for me. Maybe I will succeed, maybe I'll fail. Like a trial, you can put yourself into that. We were having trouble equating that to the striving to grow the virtue of chastity because there seems to be higher stakes. So why does there seem to be higher stakes when it comes to success and failure with regards to our sexuality?
So the question is, why is chastity like even more important? Why are the stakes even higher with chastity? I want to say, first of all, never to put yourself like, I want to grow in chastity, so I'm going to go like tend myself. St. Francis of Assisi like would have a lustful thought or see something that would distract him. He would take off his clothes and run into rose bushes or like rose thorns. He was like so scared of sin, and I think we should know our limits and in humility. Like I had the same thing. You would just think you're so strong and I want to grow. And then you like you want to go bar evangelizing, and then you're like drunk, and you're like, what did I do? You pick me up, I'm like the subway. I didn't go so well. But I think the stakes are so high with chastity, because sex is an integral part of love, and love is the most important thing in this life, and the highest thing next to a love relationship with God is a love relationship with your spouse. And so I think that's why stakes are so high. It's because it really has to do with that, the most important thing on this side of it, eternity, that you can partake in. And I was going to say something at the end of the talk, but Megan is a professional speaker, and when she goes, she's on fire. So we just ended it shortly. But this is one of my favorite books. It's A Severe Mercy. I talked about Sheldon Von Auken, and he talks about his name is Van, and his wife's name was Davy. He talked about their relationship. And he said this about sex and love, and I thought this might go to what you were saying. He said the passion, the sexual element was there, and sexual harmony was like sexual playfulness was an important dimension of our love. But it wasn't itself the whole thing. And we knew to make it the whole or even the most important element was to court disaster. Those who see love as only sex or mainly sex do not quite simply know what love is. They are the blind man assuming that the trunk of the elephant or perhaps the phallus is the whole creature. You know what phallus means? Sex is merely part of a greater thing. To be in love, as to see beauty, is a kind of adoring that turns the lover away from self. Why chastity is so important? Because repression, he talks about, it's real. Repression is real. The Archbishop just went to the pre-theology program as part of it, and he said, wow, it looks like a lot of repressed men are there. I was like, they probably are. But what, you can live chastity as repression. But you have to see, what's the whole goal of chastity? Chastity is meant to be the guard dog, which protects your heart, so you can fall genuinely in love with another person. Why the stakes are so high is because chastity can severely limit your ability to fall in love. When God puts that person in front of you, and you're not ready, I can't imagine that tragedy. Not to go on too long. My wife, so I just had dropped the pre-theology program, discerned out with my spiritual director, and I was walking to a praise and worship, and there was this girl visiting. She's walking out, she had dreads, her eyebrow pierced, and she's like, hi. And I'm like, oh my God. It was like that moment. And it just struck me, and she's my wife now. Crazy story. But what the pre-theology program did for me, help keep my heart pure and ready for that moment. I can't imagine the tragedy at that moment of being steeped in pornography, steeped in viewing women as when she was walking out, I didn't see her, that beauty, and I just saw like, she looks good. That would have been a tragedy. I would have missed out on our three kids, everything like that. So the stakes are so high because it's about falling in love, and that's the most important thing.
Well, I have nothing to say. That was
Alive.
Okay. If you are like me, and you're going to need at least the rest of the night to process all of that, we have a place for you to go. Before I give all of the advertisements and closings for the night, can we please give a enthusiastic round of applause? Man, it takes a lot to make me speechless, and I'm just going to read what is on this paper. So, couple of announcements, closing announcements. Number one, if you have not already, please join our Facebook group. There is a group on the Book of Face that will tell you everything that we have coming up. Did you catch my little joke there? It was funny. That will tell you everything that's coming up, including next week's speaker. We are going to have none other than the Culture Project's fearless leader, Christina Barba. She's going to drop her wisdom for us. So please, round of applause for her. Thank you. This is great. I'm like, clap, and you guys are like, okay. Speaking of speakers, we have a special announcement. All of you came here under the impression that next week was the last week, and I know that you felt the same sorrow in your hearts that I have felt about this upcoming event and closing, and so I'm going to talk a lot more about, just like, stall. Okay, so on this part, on another part, just keep talking, I'll do that. So,
see you, Joe.
Do you want me to stall for you?
I was just telling the tiger joke, so.
Really quick, something to just keep in mind, or look out for. We're working with the Theology of Body Institute to have a course for young adults, and even youth ministers, because we're youth and young adult. Pray for us. This summer. So, and the Theology of Body course offers a one-week immersion course, which is phenomenal. If you can do it, I would highly suggest it, but it's not totally practical for a lot of people, so we're going to make it like a long weekend, so potentially only have to take a day off. So just something to think about, keep your eyes and ears open for. Do you want me to tell Tiger joke?
You want to tell Tiger joke?
Is there a ball joke?
Wait, there are more. Now we're just group announcements. Just kidding, stay seated. This is done.
Hi everyone, I'm Stephanie Deutsch. Thank you so much for coming to these. These have been amazing. While we're stalling, I wanted to announce an amazing opportunity you guys have to participate in another Culture Project event this spring. April 29th is our annual spring banquet. Like swanky dinner and an awesome speaker and a fine time. It is a fundraiser, but it's an awesome time. There will be other great young adult events to follow. Just keep posted. But if you guys are interested in, do you work in a high school, or do you have parents that would be interested, or would you like to become better parts of the Culture Project? Come to Come to our spring banquet April 29th. Thanks.
Woo! All right. So for the record, we were stalling waiting for this slide. Wait for it. There you go! Stop it! I know that you were like me, and you were sad that this was coming to a close, and so we decided that it's not. We are actually going to have two more events. We're going to have next week with Christina Barba, who is wonderful in every way, and then the week after that, April 6th, right here in this room, we are going to hear Christopher West speak to us about the beauty of theology of the body. Speaking about theology of the body, I want to see every single one of you at McShane's in Narberth. It's on a different slide. Could you press that, Megan? Thank you. Okay. So, right here, guys, that address is located 5 minutes away from here. So you leave here, you go there, best sweet potato fries you will ever have in your whole life, and a lot of great people. And, okay, perfect. So, We are gonna close out this event. Father Felicity, would you mind closing us with a blessing? He's like, what?
It's the Holy Spirit. Woo!
Lacey, who runs across rooms on my behalf.
God is good. All the time. And all the time.
God is good. All right, thank you. Megan and Jacob, aren't they awesome?
They are.
Those are the children for Chastity, aren't they awesome? Let's be mindful we're in God's presence. Be in the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, we ask that you strengthen within all of us the deep self-love that you call forth by your great love for us, so that we can love the gift of chastity in every way and be a revelation of your love for us to all we come in contact with. We ask you, Lord, that you allow our hearts to be pure and free so that we can be the children that you call us to be. And we ask this all through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with you.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. God's good?
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Thank you so much, Father. All right, y'all, that is a wrap for tonight, unless you were doing the smart thing, which means coming to McShay's right now. We're just going to take a few minutes to clean up, so if you wouldn't mind helping with that, we can stack it.